So good afternoon, everybody. You're here on the CSO booth for a demonstration regarding the technical NATO activity, which is called MSG-145. What is 145? That's about C2 and simulation interoperability. And what we want to achieve is to make a smooth connection between the C2 area and the simulation world. The overview of this 20 minutes approximately presentation is the following. First, we would like to share with you what are the missions and the organization of this technical activity, and then to provide you some insight regarding the use case about tactical data link and C2 SIM. Then I will show you what are the architecture and different components of the demonstration that we will run afterwards, and then share with you some lessons learned, lessons identified, and what is the way forward. What is the mission statement of this technical activity? So there are three main points to keep in mind. The first one is about the assessment of the C2 SIM standard. That's the first point. The second one is to implement the standard in terms of extension focusing on tactical data link. And the third key point is about STANAG. We want this standard to become a STANAG. What is the vision of C2 SIM? What the vision is, what is in what will happen in 20 years forward. So what we clearly would like is to have a plug-and-play C2 and simulation connection. So for the end user, not to deal with technical things, you know, and then in order to have a full deployment of different use cases regarding the simulation working smoothly with the C2 system, whatever it is for forces readiness, to support operation, and also, I mean, to support acquisition. So it addresses both operation areas, but also the technical area when we are talking about acquisition. We have also to go back to another organization, and this organization is called the CISO, Simulation Interoperability Standard Organization. This is where the standards come from in the MNS area. And then also there is NATO, and NATO role in regarding the MSG-145 is to assess experiment standards made by NATO, but also to feedback to the CISO, the lessons learned, in order for the standard to be enriched, improved based on experiences provided by the CSO body. This is the roadmap, the different activities that we have scheduled at the beginning of this technical activity. And then you can see that we started in 2016 and we are more or less in the middle of the river. And we started the activity with a theoretical C2 SIM standard assessment. And right now we are in the implementation, experimentation phase. And you will see that we are experiencing different use cases where C2 SIM will be applied. And then next year we are moving to the final report development, and we are moving to share with the community the information we have collected, and also to move forward the STANAG. What about the organization? So the organization is very simple. Two subgroups. One is about the C2 SIM assessment, and the other one is about the use case experimentation of the standard. And in between, we have a technical coordinator, and his role is a very important and critical role because he has to feedback to the community or the lessons learned. And you can see here, in fact, with the different flags, that we are in nine nations, sorry, on board. What are we doing? What do we provide? What are the main works when we are assessing the standard? So it is quite important to review the usability of a core data model, because this standard is based on a core data model, which is a minimum set of interchange information. And then there is a mechanism in order to extend such a logical core data model in order to map with specific interoperability requirements addressed by different use cases. And within this assessment, we are checking the usefulness of this core data model, and also we are checking the effectiveness, completeness of the documentation. What about the implementation subgroup, use case subgroup? So this use case subgroup has to provide something which is quite important. This is the sandbox. What is the sandbox when we are talking about C2SIM? So the sandbox is something for the community, for the nations that want to experiment, that want to get some more knowledge about C2SIM, to use the sandbox in order to make the connection of national simulation in a C2SIM environment, or it could be also a C2 using a MNS simulation that is provided by the sandbox. So this is clearly a tool set that the nation are able to use to assess, to get the knowledge about the C2SIM standard. Also, there is something quite new within this technical activity and the in the implementation. This is the adoption of an operational, conceptual, and execution scenario concept. That is to say, we want to be able to track the end user requirements expressed in terms of information exchange down to technical interoperability, where we exchange the information at the low level of detail. And then we have to develop extensions. What are the different use cases addressed by this technical activity? There are a number, and you can see here that according to each of them, you have some nations willing to participate, leading such use cases. And for the one we are interested in today, Tactical Data Link is led by France. So, right now, I would like to give the floor to Laurent. Laurent is a TDL expert, and he has to brief you regarding what is TDL, but also what are the rationales of this demonstration, the reason why we were willing to execute such a TDL experimentation. So,
what about tactical data links? Tactical data links are used to exchange information between tactical systems to share some tracks, real tracks, detected tracks, to send commands, control, and to have the unique picture of the tactical situation. At this moment, there is a lot of data links used: Link 11, Link 16, Link 22, VMF. And so on. So tactical data links is increasing in network operation more and more, and we have to test, to validate systems, to train operators, and for the moment we used the real systems, so on the ground, in the air, but it's at the end it's very expensive because we use the real platforms with operators. And so, yes, it's very expensive. We can also test and train operators on the ground by simulated terminal, MIS terminal or DTS for Link 11, and connect the real platforms to the IP network by using a simple protocol, NATO protocol. But at the end, it's the same thing. We use real systems, we use operators, and there are a lot of constraints about that. So the idea is to develop a generic data link used by C2SIM, and to create specific messages, specific fields that we can exchange for the simulation. So like that, we are not obliged to develop yourself your own DLP in a simulator, to code, decode messages, to send recurrence rate, specific recurrence rate, to have also access to the STANAG, because you must have access to the STANAG to develop your own DLP. So, and for example, if I take the STANAG 5516 for the Link 16, the last version contain more than 11,000 pages. So it's very hard work to develop one system in a simulator. So we use the C2SIM standard propose an overcome interoperability. So we use we add extension in C2SIM to generate generic messages. So like that, we can have we can simulate real tactical data link like Link 11, Link 16, or if you want, you can develop your own national data link with C2SIM. We are at the end generic. So we can have different type of units, C2 units like networks, or non-C2 units like fighters. And we split the STANAG in three different services. First one, surveillance, to maintain the tactical situation, to send position of units, position of detected tracks, and also management messages like correlation, drop, etc. We have also services about command, to exchange information and command messages between C2 systems, like an order, like a threat warning, etc. And then control services is to exchange specific messages between C2 and non-C2, or non-C2 to non-C2, like take or release control, like flight plan or mission assignment. So this table shows you how we can split data links in different services, and for each service we can see all messages we can find. So during our development we have found 16 messages with 16 elementary type and 20 enumeration that we include into the C2SIM to allow you to transmit tactical data messages in the simulation protocol.
Thanks, Laurent. So right now, an insight regarding the use case and how we have developed it and what is the architecture. So, but first of all, I would like to introduce the scenario. I mean, you should understand what is the storyboard regarding what we would like to execute, to run in using the simulation and the C2. So there are only five steps, so quite quick. The first one is the exchange of initial information between two units. One is an AWACS and the other one is a fighter. And this is a TDL French demonstration. So what is the fighter? Which fighter do we use? You have an idea? That's a Rafale. That's a Rafale, of course. So here the fighter is a Rafale, and here we have the AWACS. So the first thing is, in the step one, I mean, for these two units to exchange their position. The second step is, you know, within the AWACS there are sensors, plenty of sensors. And the AWACS is able to detect a hostile threat. And then he has to inform the fighter which radars are less performant than the AWACS that there is a threat in that area. That's the case in using the G3.2 TDL message. Step three, the AWACS assigned a mission to the Rafale. You have to proceed the visual identification of this threat. Step four, the Rafale is flying Chinese route and flying towards the threat, and then using his own sensor will detect the threat. And then he has to inform the AWACS about this detection. And what is the work, the activity within the AWACS is to make track correlation. Is to make track correlation, and then to say that, okay, the threat I've identified and the one you have identified, this is the same. Step five, I mean, the threat will withdraw, will fly back to the north, and then the Rafale will receive a new order from the AWACS to seize the mission and then to return to base, to return to the airfield. That's a storyboard, okay? In order to do so, we have implemented 9 TDL messages. But this is generic TDL, and you will understand after that, within this architecture, how it works. So we are using Starlink, which is a TDL C2 system, operationally deployed. It is used by the French armed forces currently, and it is used in Mali for the Barkhane operation. We use also Direct CGF, which is an air simulation, and this simulation is made by Direct CGF. This simulation has 2 interoperability outputs. One is about HLADIS and the other is about C2SIM. So within this architecture, Direct CGF will generate some rate regarding the entities it has to manage, and then it will use by the radar model that is inside Starlink, and this is the radar of the AWACS to proceed the detection. That's the only reason, I mean, to have a DIS HLA outputs for Direct CGF. The second thing is about C2SIM. So both Starlink and Direct CGF are talking TDL, but Starlink is talking real TDL, L16, but not Direct CGF. That's the reason why we have implemented a C2SIM capability, a generic one, and then there's a gateway in between that will make the translation between C2SIM and real TDL. What is the added value of such a concept is for the MNS world. They don't have to take care, they don't have to deal, they don't have to have the knowledge about TDL. They should have only the knowledge about C2SIM standard. And what is TDL, in fact, is made by experts in that area. And you know that being a TDL expert takes a while. So that's the architecture. So right now we will move and we'll switch to the demonstration. So for that we'll have in the upper screen Starlink and Direct CGF display, and you will have the storyboard on the other screen. So let's switch and we will right now perform the execution of the scenario. This is Starlink here. So remember, this is the operational C2 system, the one which is used by the French Armed Forces and deployed today. The initial configuration in Starlink, this is the AWACS. AWACS is here. And here is the airfield. And you can see there is a small picture here. Can you read it? Blended Warrior. We are Operation Blended Warrior involved. And you know why? Any idea? Because we have no connection here with any network, but we are Blended Warrior. This is because, can you make a zoom please? Because you are in fact operating in the Emerald City, which is the database of Operation Blended Warrior. So OBW, I mean, kindly provided us, I mean, this area in order for us to be able to operate. And this is a starter because next year we'll be much more involved in OBW. These tracks here just show you the altitude of the corresponding units. Can you switch please to Direct CGF? Thanks. So this is the simulation. So in the simulation, the AWACS, and this is the racetrack of the AWACS. The Rafale is corresponding racetrack, and also the hostile threat in the north with the flying routes towards the south. How is made Direct CGF? This is the order of battle here. This is the overlays management. On the right side, you have some information about the units, like the orientation, the speed, the altitude. Next overlay, you have information about the weapon devices that are on board the units. You can see here 30 millimeter cannon. You can see here that air-ground missile. Next overlay is about the different sensors that are also on board the Rafale. Next overlay, that's about, and it's quite important, that capability, because that's about the L-16 capability. So for this demonstration, the RR file must have it, otherwise we will miss the communication. And next is about different threat that the sensor of the Rafale will be able to display. So that's it. Let's go back to Starlinks. And let's go back to Starlinks. We will run the simulation. And you can see here that I have no information about the Rafale. I have no information about the threats, but in exchanging PPLI, in exchanging position in a C2SIM way, but also in a simple translation way, then right now I receive using TDL messages the information regarding the Rafale, his speed, track number, his altitude as well, and also the AWACS detects and treat up to the north, and then will generate the corresponding messages to inform the Rafale about the treat up to the north. Step 3, so the C2 operators in using Starlinks will generate an order, a mission assignment for the Rafale pilot in order to proceed VID, visual identification. So it's done, and you can see here that the Rafale changed his route and is flying right now towards the threats up to the north. If we switch in direct CGF, we can see that when receiving the order, the Rafale changes route. So next step, staying in direct CGF, we can also display the radar overlay. And then you can see within the range of the inboard radar of the Rafale has a detection about the threat. And then from that, we'll exchange internal detection with the Starlinks operator on board of the AWACS, and also the AWACS will perform the track number correlation. So this is something that I cannot show you because it's done automatically by the systems. It is done automatically within Starlinks, and the only thing that's changed in the simulation, this is the knowledge of the entity. So the entity model in direct CGF has the information right now that there is a threat somewhere, and this threat has been correlated. Next step, switch to direct CGF in order to order the unit to fly back to the north to withdraw, and then we'll switch back to Starlinks, and we will assign a new order for the Rafale to seize the mission. So this is the case here, seize the mission, and then another order to return to the base RTB, and then you will see that moving back to direct CGF, sorry, the Rafale will also once again change its route. So, and this will conclude the demonstration part of the presentation. So we can stay with this picture, and the scenario can continue to run, of course. And this is the last information I would like to share with you. That's about the lessons identified because they are not yet taken into account. It will become a lessons learned when it will enrich the standard. This is we have experienced the extension mechanism within for this use case, for this TDL use case. And this is the first time we have also we have been through the process. I cannot explain you this process in detail today, but we have experienced the fact that to describe the scenario in terms of operational point of view, in developing some NATO operational view, in using the NATO architecture view, and then we have developed also some conceptual scenario point of view, and it was within the NAF where we use for that the NATO system view, and then from that we have produced some technical messages that will represent the executable scenario point of view. Okay, and you can read also some other lessons learned. What you have to keep in mind, this is the last point here. This is the first TDL use case using the C2SIM draft standard. And this is the first time we have developed such extension implementing a use case. So that's a very fruitful lessons learned, fruitful experience. And then I guess we will be able to, maybe next year, to being here, to watch some other demonstrations. Remember, 5 use cases are under development within this technical activity, and also within the literature, I may say, we'll be able to learn more because it is scheduled to make some publication at the CISOBODY, but publication also during NMHG conferences, publication during also ICCRTS conferences as well. So we will in fact share with the overall community every lessons learned. So thanks a lot for attending this demonstration. I really appreciate it here. And don't hesitate to ask any questions. We are staying here with Laurent. Thank you, Laurent.